Hello everyone, how are you? My name is Marcela Villan. I'm in Buenos Aires, Argentina, and I'm going to include environmental education into your lessons. I am going to tell you what environmental education is, how we can take it into our lessons, and when the moment to include environmental education into EFL classrooms is the proper one. Okay, so as you can see in my presentation, my name, as I told you, is Marcela Villan. I'm a qualified teacher of English here in Argentina. I'm a passionate lifelong learner. I've got several diplomas, right? And I've been working in bilingual education here at in Buenos Aires for more than 30 years. The most important thing is that I've been working in a classroom for more than 30 years, so everything that I am going to tell you works because I've tried it before. As you can see here, this is my LinkedIn logo, and as you can see, my LinkedIn banner, and as you can see, it's full of different icons, full of different logos. I'm a global educator as well. I work with teachers all around the world, basically on the topic of climate education, which nowadays is so much in fashion, because we really need it. That's the point. Well, today's agenda then, we are going to talk about why we need to integrate environmental education or climate education into our classroom. We are going to talk about what we need to include into our classrooms, when we can do so, and how we can do so. First of all, to begin with, I'm going to tell you why we need to take environmental education or climate education into our lessons. Pay attention to this video. Thank you. Okay, well, let me just go back, escape. Okay, this video was not done by me. You can find easily this video in YouTube. It's called Man, by a British man called Steve Katz. And it really summarizes, right, everything that we are doing to our dear Earth, to our dear Mother Earth. This second video, which is called Man 2020, appeared in the year 2010. This one appeared just some years ago when the pandemic struck. Okay, shocking really. What is it that we are doing to nature? What is it that we are doing to our world? That's why we need to take environmental education and, in connection, climate action into our lessons. Now, if we move forward, right, let me just try again. Here it is. We need to take environmental education, climate action, climate education into our lessons, because according to a new report published by UNESCO, education is not currently giving our students the necessary knowledge to adapt, to act, and to respond to climate change and environmental crises. UNESCO goal is to make environmental education a co-curriculum component by the year 2024-25, and we are in the year 2023 already, so that students acquire knowledge, skills, values, and attitudes to introduce positive change in the climate, in the planet. So here it is. What I have just told you. Also, it says that it is working with its 193 member states to support curriculum reform and track progress to ensure everyone acquires the knowledge, skills, values, and attitudes to introduce positive change and protect our planet's future. Here in Argentina, we already have our environmental law, right, and environmental education law, and I think it's really important. But it appeared just 2 years ago, and not everyone has taken it into the classrooms yet, and that is what we need to do. Because as teachers, we have a big role to play, and that is what we have to take advantage of. This is what Antonio Guterres, the United Nations Secretary, said last month. I'm very frustrated that global leaders are not still giving the climate emergency the action and investment it requires. Words are not enough. Without climate action, climate catastrophe is coming for all of us. And this is really important because, as I have just said, teachers have a big role to play. We are with the small generation, the generation that will become the leaders of tomorrow, the generation that will change the world. So let's start changing the world right now. Let's start making real change makers right now. So what is it that we need to do to be able to take all these things into our lessons? First of all, we need to reframe education. We have to, point out the important things we need to teach in our lessons. We have to work on students' interest to get them involved. We have to raise awareness on these real world issues. We have to build agency and self-efficacy. We have to develop meaningful projects for our students to work on. In that case, we will be using project-based learning. and we have to work more on skills than on content. But in most of our cases, we are teachers of English, and as teachers of English, we teach language. So what is it that we need to do to take all this into our lessons? Well, we have to remember the 21st century skills. The 21st century skills are the skills that our students need to survive in this new century, in this new world. Critical thinking, creativity, collaboration, and communication. The things that everyone mentions nowadays, but that really must be taken to our lessons. We have to remember all these concepts. Education for sustainable development, sustainability, the three E's, environment, economy, equity, which are the pillars of sustainability. The circular economy, how important it is, right, to leave the linear economy we most of our countries are in, that is to say, I buy, I just use, and I throw it, and go into a circular economy in which things can be recycled and reused again. Sustainable development, how important it is for our future. Clean energies. We know that fossil fuels are dying out. We are not going to have more coal, more oil, more gas in a few years. And we need to start using clean energies. That is to say, energies that are not going to damage the world. Yeah, the one that comes from the air, wind energy, right? Eolic energy, hydroelectric power, right? Geothermal energy, all the energies that are not going to die out in a few years. Climate change, right? What's happening to our weather? What's happening to our climate, right? What's happening to it? Well, we need to take climate action to be able to solve this issue. Carbon dioxide emissions, right? Why is it that all this is happening? And the carbon footprint, that is to say what we are leaving behind. But the point is that we, as teachers of English, are not taught about all these issues at teacher training courses. So we need to train ourselves. We need to watch videos. We need to read about all these issues. We need to come to these sort of workshops, to these sort of things in which we can learn a little more about what is happening. But really, self-education is the most important thing, right? Start getting interested in these topics, because these are the topics that your students are going to be interested in, because these are the topics that are really nowadays in fashion and that everyone needs to talk about. In connection with the when and the how, what is it that we need to do? When do we need to introduce all this into our lessons? How can we introduce all this into our lessons if we are just teachers of English that need to follow a curriculum, right, and need to reach a certain curriculum by the end of a year? Complicated, isn't it? We need to become facilitators of knowledge. We have to leave the usual place in which we are standing, right, being the center of the classes and teaching reported speech and teaching conditional sentences and teaching passive voice, and become facilitators in the sense that we have to make our students become real activists, right, in the things that they want to learn. We want to make our students become active. We need to go to active learning. That is to say, our students need to learn, right, on their own what they really want to learn. Have a look at this phrase. This is wonderful. I don't want to protect the environment, but I want to create a world where the environment doesn't need protecting. And for that, our students need to know what they have to do. And that is the role that teachers have to play. We have to take all these into our lessons to be able to make them realize what they need to do to protect the environment. For that, we have the Sustainable Development Goals. These 17 goals that were created by the United Nations in the year 2015. Before these 17 development goals, the United Nations created in the year 2000 eight goals, which were called the Millennium Goals, that were supposed to be reached by the year 2015, in which there were some issues, certain issues that the United Nations wanted to tackle through the governments, of developing countries. That was not a very good idea, because we all know that developing countries, and in that case I include my country as well, sometimes do not have the possibility, do not have the means to be able to tackle certain issues. So, and when I say that, I refer to the economic part. But in the year 2015, when the year 2015 came, the United Nations realized that there were more things to be done. And that's how they created the 17 Sustainable Development Goals. These Sustainable Development Goals that nowadays we all know about them, right, are 17 goals that need to be known by our students. No poverty, zero hunger, good health and well-being, quality education, gender equality, clean water and sanitation, affordable and clean energy, decent work and economic growth, industry, innovation and infrastructure, reduced inequalities, sustainable cities and communities, responsible consumption and production, climate action, life below water, life on land, peace, justice and strong institutions, partnership for the goals. And as you can see, all these 17 goals cover very important topics, very important issues that our students need to know about. But all these 17 goals do not work independently. They are all interrelated, they are all interconnected. By working on one of them, you are working on all the others. So that's why we need to take action urgently. How can we take this into our lessons? I will tell you in a minute. We need to point out target 4.7, yeah, from goal number 4, which is quality education. This target says that by the year 2030, we have to ensure that all learners acquire the knowledge, the skills needed to promote sustainable development, including, among others, through education for sustainable development and sustainable lifestyles, human rights, gender equality, promotion of a culture of peace and non-violence, global citizenship and appreciation of cultural diversity, and of culture's contribution to sustainable development. So, if by the year 2030, and we are already in the year 2023, that is to say 7 years ahead from now, we have to reach this, how can we teachers in general, it doesn't matter if you did to teach English or whatever you teach, how can we help our students? Again, by making them take action, by making them know about all the things that really affect our lives. The world becomes what we teach. This is really a book. It's a book by Zoe Well from the Institute of Humane Education in the United States. I really love it. And it really incites students to become active leaders of our world, to become active change makers nowadays, right, to make a better future. Climate action goal number 13, right? Okay, our house is on fire. It's really burning. It's really dying out, right? Life is fading. If we don't do something about it, right, the world is really going to suffer big consequences, yeah? And our students need to know that. So what is it that you must do? You must make your students become solutionaries. That is one of the real ideas, of the good ideas that you are going to find in this book, The World Becomes What You Teach. You have to make your students become real change makers, right? They need to know, first of all, what is really happening in our world, and then they need to take action. They have to do something, right, in connection with that. So, as I have just said, taking all the things into a language in language lesson may become a bit complicated, may be a bit complicated. But you all know that in most of our language books nowadays, we do find these things, we do find these topics. So when the topic appears, let's try to make the most of it. Project-based learning is a solution. Let's try to make our students create a project to work on that. The idea always is to start working on the global perspectives, and that is when you're going to include a bit of global citizenship in your lessons as well. Trying to get to know what is happening with that topic that your student is reading about at a global level. Then trying to see what is happening at a national level. Finally, trying to see what is happening at a local level. And in that way, making our students find the solution to that problem at a local level. Because if we work at a local level, we are going to be helping the world globally. Every small step we take counts. Every small step multiplied by a lot of people will really produce the big change. So we really need to take that into consideration. We need to make our students work on thinking skills. And when I mention thinking skills, I'm not just mentioning critical thinking, which is the idea of discerning the important issues. We need also to work on systems thinking. That is to say, we need to make our students understand the interconnections. If I am working on this, how am I really helping the other issues, right? Remember I told you that sustainability has got three pillars. It has the economic pillar, the environmental pillar, and the equity or social pillar. In that case, we need to help the three of them. So if we are working on this issue, how are we really helping the environmental pillar? How are we really helping the economic pillar? How are we really helping the society pillar, the social pillar? Strategic thinking. Our students need to think of the strategies to be able to help. And in that case, by thinking of these strategies, you are going to find wonderful solutions because they have great imagination. And we need to work on that. We need to work on that, not only teach them and give them input all the time, right? We need to take all that out and we need to work on their creative thinking. Our students are really creative. And you know that creativity is taught. Creativity can be worked on. So, I mean, we need to take advantage of our lessons to work on this. So how can we do so? Take advantage of every opportunity you find. Every opportunity that you find will be useful. When you start a new unit, and that unit is about, I don't know, cars, for example, let's make our students investigate on cars and how they affect the world, right? If your unit is about nature, well, let's try to investigate about the importance of nature and what we need to do to take care of that. Let's take advantage of every focus we work on in language to be able to work on the other areas as well. You can also introduce all these topics into our lessons by working on readers. If you're a language teacher, I am sure that you take readers into your lessons. Well, A Long Walk to Water, for example, is a wonderful book by Linda Sue Parker, in which she talks about the problem of the water in Africa. That's just a serious issue. We all know about that. We know that Africa is a water poor continent and that they have to do lots of things to be able to get water to drink every day. So, reading this book and then making your students work on that issue is going to be a wonderful introduction. Also by working, for example, on The Boy Who Harnessed the Wind, another story about Africa, an African boy that discovered how to solve the problem of the water there. It's also a film now that you can find in Netflix, right? It's also a good possibility. So books, readers, films, right? Here you have a documentary, An Inconvenient Truth. This documentary in which the ex-American vice president talks about the idea of global warming and what is really happening. He explains detail by detail what is happening to our climate nowadays, okay, and about the carbon dioxide emissions and all the things that we have been doing these years. It's very interesting to take into our classrooms, especially if you have adolescents, right? Adolescent students that are really very serious about all these issues. For little kids, you have The Lorax. The Lorax is a wonderful animated film in which you find all the question of nature, the trees, the importance of the trees, and in which students can get interested in these topics as well. You can also work with biographies. I'm sure that if you are a language teacher, you teach how to write a biography. So you can work on the biography of these wonderful people. Do you know them? Do you really know them? Jane Goodall, of course, who doesn't know her, right? She's a real idol for all the ones interested in climate action. Jane Goodall, who still at her age is fighting for the world and is fighting for the environment. Malala. Malala is a very young girl who is working hard for sustainable goal number 4, education. And Greta Thunberg, another very young girl, activist, both of them, who is working on climate action. Sustainable goal number 13, and they are doing very important things, right? So, I mean, they have to read their biographies. They have to know how it all started, how they became interested in helping the world like this, right? And in that sense, you are going to be helping also their minds to become open, right, to these things, to be open to these things and say, these girls are young. I may be similar to them as well, right? It's not that we are going to make activists if we do that much better, but I mean, we are going to open their eyes to all these things, and that's good. We can also work on infographics. You can find them easily right online, yeah, especially in the United Nations website, in which you can learn information right about the percentage of people that get access to water, of the percentage of people that do this, the percentage of people that do that. In that sense, you can also work mathematics. You can also take mathematics into your lessons. So there are very different ways in which you can talk about all these issues, in which you can take all these issues into your lessons. And as I have just told you, we as teachers have a very big role to play. It doesn't matter if you teach English or whatever you teach. You teach human beings. So as teaching human beings, right, we must be part of the solutions, right? And we must take all these things into the lessons as soon as possible. Let's start the year by doing that. Alone, we can do so little, but together, we can do so much, really. Remember, a contagious teacher, a contagious educator has passion. An educator has passion, leads change, and seeks to add value to others. So, this is something that I want to tell you. It doesn't matter if other teachers don't do it, but you must do it. You must take all this into your lessons, right? Because you must be the first step in the chain, right, to change your students' mind. I'm sure that they are going to be really grateful for you. In my case, I work a lot with project-based learning, right, something that I told you before. I am lucky in a way because I'm not only a teacher of English, I work in a bilingual school and I teach environmental education and I also teach global perspectives. My students sit for international examinations at the end of the year. They sit for IGCSE examinations by Cambridge University, environmental education, environmental management exam, and global perspectives. And so in a way, I have the big possibility of taking all these issues into my lessons very easily. But if you don't teach these things and you just teach language, remember how important it is that your students understand that they have to become active, that they have to be active and find solutions to our world. So if you start doing it now, your students will really, really be grateful in the future. When the year 2030 comes, I don't know if we are going to be able to reach the 17 sustainable development goals that the United Nations wants, because they have to be reached by the year 2030. It's also called the United Nations 2030 Agenda. But yes, in a way, I am sure that if we start working with these things, we are going to be able to solve most issues. Yeah, if not reach a real solution, we are going to find a lot of very small good steps to that. Yeah, so really, thank you for listening to me. You can also follow me on Instagram. I'm under the name of 21st Century Tools, also on Facebook. But before finishing, I just want you to show a video. I want to show you another video. It's short, but it's very interesting, and I want you to pay close attention to this.
We are constantly being bombarded by problems that we face, and sometimes we can get completely overwhelmed. The story of a hummingbird is about this huge forest being consumed by a fire. All the animals in the forest come out and they are transfixed, and they watch the forest burning, and they feel very overwhelmed, very powerless. Except this little hummingbird. It says, I'm going to do something about the fire. So it flies to the nearest stream, takes a drop of water, and puts it on the fire, and goes up and down, up and down, up and down, as fast as it can. In the meantime, all the other animals, much bigger animals, like the elephant with a big trunk, could bring much more water. They are standing there helpless, and they are saying to the hummingbird, what do you think you can do? You're too little. This fire is too big. Your wings are too little. And you're big, so small. You can only bring a small drop of water at a time. But as they continue to discourage it, it turns to them without wasting any time and tells them, I am doing the best I can. And that, to me, is what all of us should do. We should always feel like a hummingbird. I may feel insignificant, but I certainly don't want to be like the animals watching as the planet goes down the drain. I will be a hummingbird. I will do the best I can.
Really wonderful message, right? We have to do the best we can. Right, like the hummingbird, the same, yeah? So by taking these things into your lessons, I am sure that you will be doing the best you can. And as I said before, it doesn't matter if others don't do it, because it's not all doom and gloom. We also have to take this out of our minds, right? It's not that the world is going to die out soon, right? There is also hope, and you have to create that hope into your students' mind. Last month, for example, the United Nations Environmental Program posted something very interesting. You know that the ozone layer, which is the shield that protects us from the UV radiation, has a big hole. I'm sure that you have heard about the hole of the ozone layer and the UV radiation entering our Earth and, of course, affecting our skin with lots of skin cancers and also cataracts in our eyes. But apparently, thanks to the big effort of governments and politicians that have been working on it, and companies and industries and factories that have been working hard on reducing the emissions of all these chlorofluorocarbons that affect the ozone layer so much, the ozone layer is going back to the 1980s values. So we are really going back, and that's wonderful. Yeah, we are going back to the original numbers, and that's wonderful. Yeah, it's not all doom and gloom. It's not all that bad. And that's why you have to take all this into our lessons, right? Into your lessons, to be able to teach your students that if we all work together, there will be a solution. Yeah, remember, you as a teacher have a big role to play. You are part of all this, and you must take action. You must make your students take actions as well. Really, thank you very much. Here you have some websites that you can really go into if you are more interested on activities and things that you can take into your lessons, the globalgoals.org and the world's largest lesson.globalgoals.org, and of course americasbritishcouncil.org climate connection, in which you are going to find lots of ideas to take into your lessons and to be able to work on. Thank you. Bye bye.